Voilà, je vous demande d'accueillir Lara Bloom, la présidente d'Ehlers-Danlos Society.
Good morning, everyone. For most unprepared, I think I can wing it. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit this morning about what the new criteria means for us, for patients, because we've been waiting a really long time for this to be done. As you can see, we had 20 years of neglect, of having all of the negative consequences of there being this big gap between 1997, when the criteria was last updated, where we had six different types of EDS. And EDS was thought to mean that you're a little bit bendy, you've got some stretchy skin, and that was about all, really. And in between those 20 years, we learnt, mainly clinically and anecdotally, that there are a lot of comorbidities that come with EDS. And there was some published work on this, but there wasn't this shift in understanding and validation amongst most of the medical community. Until last year, when we republished the diagnostic criteria and for the first time published management and care guidelines across all of the different comorbidities. And why did we do that? I mean, I think everyone in this room can relate to all of these statements. My doctor doesn't know what it is. You know, when you go to the hospital, go to a clinic, and you can see over their shoulder that they're Googling, what is EDS? I mean, that simply isn't good enough in 2017, 2018. My doctor just thinks EDS means I'm a bit bendy with no multi-systemic issues. Now, we don't yet have enough published evidence to include those multi-systemic issues in the diagnostic criteria. But we can see that there is a prevalence of this, and what we're asking these doctors to understand and to respect is that they need to be managed and they need to be treated. And then that then causes the issue of these people can't get the management and care that they need. So they're actually becoming a lot iller than they need to be. Who can relate to this statement? No one believes me. Has everyone had that in this room? I mean, I know that wherever I go, no matter where you are in the world, no matter how close you are to an EDS clinic, there are people along your life that have not believed the pain that you're going through. And then this is the thing that causes the most concern, that these people, all of us, are becoming more and more disabled and sick. Most of the time, it's not EDS that's causing the disability, it's the deconditioning, bad management, lack of validation, and lack of care. My family and friends don't get it. Nobody understands what they're going through. And because there's this, if you think doctors aren't doing it, then how can we expect family and friends to do it? So it needs to change on both sides. And then there's this issue in terms of a socioeconomic consequence of I can't work. I want to socialize. I can't live a normal life. So for all of these reasons, we had to look back and we had to move forward. So under the leadership of Francisca Malfay, there was an international meeting in Ghent in 2012, where for the first time in a long time, it brought together all of the professionals that were dedicated to making a change in this field. At that point, there wasn't an update in the diagnostic criteria, but there was the understanding that there needed to be. And this was a huge task. We then had another meeting in Glasgow in 2015. And we began to think about what can we actually do to formalize this process. And we realized that there needed to be a global organization. At the time, I was running EDS UK. And together with EDNF, we were attempting to republish this diagnostic criteria, bring everybody together in one room. And we began the outlines of building this international consortium. But as busy as EDS UK were and as busy as EDNF were, it was very hard to make sure that this was sustained and that every 2 years there would be this meeting and this assurance that the research would be updated regularly. So at the New York International Symposium in 2016 was also the launch of the global organization that I now run along with Shane Robinson in the US, the Ehlers-Danlos Society. And we're committed to really raising the funds that are going to make the difference to get the research that needs to be done in areas such as the hypermobile gene discovery, or genes, because we think it's definitely more than one gene, and the awareness that we need for in the comorbidities so that we can start including that into the diagnostic criteria if relevant. And we're now working towards the next international meeting, which is going to be in Ghent in September of this year. So this is the Ehlers-Danlos Society. This is what we're about. Strength begins with hope. And we really hope that we are starting to make a difference. There's been a tremendous shift in the past 3 years. Like I said, we have the papers. We have people that are starting to respect and understand what we're trying to do. And we hope that in time that will reflect the care that you are all receiving as EDS patients. We have now the formalization of the International Consortium on Ehlers-Danlos Syndromes and Related Disorders. Now, this is a totally independent group of scientists, researchers, and clinicians, and it's divided into committees for all the different types of EDS. So, for example, there's a hypermobile, rarer forms, vascular, classical, and then there's working groups that cover all the different comorbidities. So, for example, gastroenterology, neurology, pain, etc. And the Ehlers-Danlos Society help facilitate the work they're doing. So we don't instruct any opinion or advise what work they should be focusing on, but we allow for it to happen in terms of a financial basis, and we help organise the meetings. And we help then disseminate the information that they are working on being published. And the first thing that they published as a group was the 2017 international classification. And I'm sure many of you have read these papers. There were 18 papers as part of the American Journal of Medical Genetics. There were 96 different medical professionals that authored the papers. As I've discussed, there was a 20-year wait. We went from 6 types to 13. And critically, hypermobility spectrum disorders were introduced, HSD. Because what happened when we did this is the criteria for hypermobile EDS became a lot stricter. And we knew that there would be a group of patients that no longer fulfilled the criteria, but were still very symptomatic, still living in pain, who still needed validation, who still needed management and care. And we knew that what was already in place wasn't good enough, so we wanted to start again. And I constantly try and remind people that this was less than 1 year ago, and it doesn't happen overnight. We have 20 years to heal. It will take time, but we are working very hard to get to a point where HSD is just as recognized as hypermobile EDS and all the other types. What we're trying to make people understand is you can be extremely ill, you could be wheelchair bound, you can have all the different comorbidities, and you can have HSD. And you can fulfill the criteria for hypermobile EDS, yet be walking around, functioning well, working 9 to 5. It's not that one is more severe than the other, it's that one meets the criteria and one doesn't. But both need to be treated and respected. And for the first time ever, we printed management and care guidelines across all the different types of comorbidities that can come with this condition. And to give you an idea of the kind of interest that is starting to build in this area, myself and Dr. Claire Francomano did a webinar to introduce the classification. And we reached over 110,000 people in a 48-hour period. I mean, that is incredible. At the end of that first day when that publication happened, I had an email in my inbox from Genomics England, who wanted to work with the society and the consortium on the EDS panel in the 100 Genomes project in the UK, and we're very proud that we've helped that panel be created. So people are starting to take note and respect what we're doing. When we did the press conference that we tried to reach out to different press agencies, we reached 70,000 people. So people are starting to tune in and listen to what we have to say. And what's our hope? The reason we did this is because we wanted to prevent mis- and underdiagnosis in the medical world. I think it's a rare thing where you have a condition where you have under a misdiagnosis in the medical world and overdiagnosis in the patient world. Because we all know how hard it is to reach a specialist. And we all know that the easiest doctor that you can visit with no wait times and no charges is Dr. Google. But that's the most dangerous doctor you can visit. So we want to try and prevent this overdiagnosis and miseducation in the patient community too. We also want this diagnosis to gain credibility and respect, which is something that it hasn't had for a very long time. And we've introduced the HSD, the hypermobility spectrum disorders, to allow everyone, whether you fulfill the genetic markers for the rarer types, the criteria for hypermobile EDS, or you fulfill the symptoms that require you to then be diagnosed with HSD. All need to be managed and validated. We then hope that that will in turn give us better data for a registry and critically for more research, because that's how we're going to learn more. That's how we're going to be able to introduce these comorbidities into the diagnostic criteria and hopefully one day find out the genes for hypermobile EDS. And then we need to prove prevalence. You've heard me publicly talk that this is not rare, this is mis and undiagnosed. Now we've got the new criteria, we are actually saying we do think this is rare. This still falls under 1 in 5,000 people. Now we feel like this is probably not the case with hypermobile EDS, but we cannot prove it yet. And in the medical world, until you can prove it, you have to stick to what you know. And right now, all the different types of EDS fall under a rare disease. So we need to prove prevalence. A lot of questions we get is it more common in females than males? Is that because women go to the doctor more than men? Or is it actually because more women are affected than men? We need to answer all of these questions. And we're asking you to use the right terminology. Ask your doctors to use the right terminology. And even if that's the smallest thing of how you write it down, we still have people, we still have doctors in the consortium that are saying type 3, type 4. And that actually went out in 1997. So it's not even that was done recently. So please use the right terminology. It's the Ehlers-Danlos syndromes as well, critically. We're not just talking about one type of EDS. In little things like the capital letters, we're trying to make the smaller letter in front of that. Consistency kind of brings clarity. And I think if everybody is using the same thing, then we're going to get a lot further. Also, joint hypermobility syndrome, we no longer use that, and that has become HSD, the hypermobility spectrum disorders. And dissemination, one of the most important things that we're taking responsibility for. There's a saying in the UK, and I don't know if it's an international thing, but you can take a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. I think that's the same with zebras. So we can have the papers, we can have these publications, we can't force the doctors to read them. So it's going to take time, and we need the patients to help us do this as well. Take the new papers that are free to download on our website, allow your doctors to read it, take it to physiotherapists, take it to your local occupational therapist, everyone that you can think of. Just keep giving this information, letting them know that it's free to access. Wiley has also in the last week just announced that they are extending the period where it was free for another year at least. There is no excuse for these doctors to not learn. It's all about education, 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 but most importantly, re-education. There is nothing worse than a doctor who thinks they know what EDS is. We need to teach them what EDS really is about. There's my contact details. If anyone ever has any questions, please do get in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you.